Joyfully noise unto the Lord, all in hands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Knowing that the Lord who is God, it is he who has made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and enter his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. For the Lord is good. How do you know on today that the Lord is good? His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. Mount Lebanon, let us prepare for worship.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, let's hear God. Praise the Lord. Excited to be in the house one more time. If you are excited to be in the house one more time, if you are excited to be in the house one more time, I'm looking for some make-away worshipers this morning. A make-away worshiper is somebody that
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. God, we thank you. God, we bless you. God, we adore you. God, we magnify you. God, we praise you. God, we praise you because you are awake-making God. God, we praise you because you are God who is, the God who was, the God who is to come. The God never sleeps nor slumber. The God who is in front and not behind. The God who leads. The God who triumphs. The God who makes a way where there seems to be no way. The God who creates streams in desert places. Thank you, God, that you can make all things new. We thank you, God, that you are a way-making God. That God, that you are a keeping God, that you are a promise-giving God this morning. So, Father, even now, your people gather in this moment, in this place, in this form, in this fashion, to bless you, to thank you, to exalt you, because you are God, and you are God alone. So we can look to anything, anyone else but you this morning, God. We bless you, we thank you, in Jesus' mighty name. Have your way in this service even now. Have your way in this service even now. Have your way in this service even now. Let there be healing in this service. Let there be anointing in this service. Let there be a glory in this service. Fill this place. Fill this temple with your presence, oh God. Have your way, oh God. Have your way, oh God. We thank you even now. As we praise you, every high thing must come down.
Help us stand. We are
brought us through. So we want you to go into the chat, welcome each other, give a testimony if you can in the chat, and let's spread the love of God here in the sanctuary. Find about six people and tell them, I'm only here because God made a way. Come on, let's continue to give God praise and the spreading of God's love.
Yeah. prayer. You can hear me trying. In my prayer, you can hear me trying. In my prayer, you can hear me trying. Step by step, all the way. Aren't you glad we serve a God who hears our prayers? I gotta say that again, baby. My mic is turned down. Aren't you glad we serve a God who hears our prayers? And I don't know if you know it, but these are praying times. We have several of our family members who are in need of prayer. Sister Ella Reed, her funeral is tomorrow. Let's continue to keep that family in prayer and support them in the home, in her homegoing service tomorrow at 10 a.m. Please keep Minister Clark in the who's in the hospital in prayer. Please keep the best family in prayer, Michelle and Linda. Michelle's son is in hospice. She went down to be with him, so let's remember to keep them in prayer. And Sister Bethel, let's keep her in prayer. That's Faith's grandmother, who is in hospice as well. So we want to make sure we keep them in prayer. Keep Sister Rooks in prayer. She's in the hospital. And all those persons in your lives that you know need prayer. We need to keep our country in prayer, amen? Many of you have heard or seen the assassination attempt on former President Trump. And here's what I've learned. If you can't say anything nice, don't say anything at all. Here's what else I learned. You can't let animosity and hatred turn into the person you are not trying to be. Don't let your animosity for somebody else take you out of character. We have no place for political violence in this world. And no matter how you feel about a person, as a child of God, we don't want to wish death on anybody. Now let me be honest. I'm sure, like, I'll speak for myself, I had some ungodly thoughts. You can be real. I've had some ungodly thoughts. And it's in those moments where we got to pray. Because we cannot let anyone have more power over us than the power of God. So we pray for our country. We pray for what's to come. And no matter what, we need to hear from God. No matter who wins in November, there's going to be a reckoning. And we have to make sure that we're focused on what we need to be focused on, because the biggest thing is to be distracted from the real fight. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood. We wrestle against principalities and wickedness in high places. This is bigger than one person. So let's stay focused as the Lord has called us to do. Amen? And that way that we focus is through the power of prayer. So let's prepare our hearts for prayer. Let's go to the altar in prayer. We vote. We take action. We also pray. It's all a part of it. So let's come to the altar and pray for those who are on our hearts. Pray for those who are in need. Pray for the leadership of this country. Pray for the future. That no matter what goes on, there's a generation that we have to make sure are protected. Now, even in the midst of it all, God is a sustainer. And God is a waymaker. So whatever issue you have, whatever name you want to bring before the Lord, call it out now as we go to God in prayer.
to the end of this prayer. We come before you with grateful hearts. We come before you knowing that you sit high and you look low. That the prayers that were already, the prayer requests that were already mentioned, you knew about it even before the manifestation of the world. And we thank you. We thank you, Father God, that there's nothing too small or too big for you. So, Lord Jesus, you know every prayer concern that's at this altar, Father. You know those who are sick. You know those who are grieving. You know those who are in the hospital or nursing homes. You know our needs. You know those who need provision, Father God. And we thank you, Father. We thank you for allowing us to bring those prayer concerns to you in the name of Jesus. Not to our friends, not to our family, but to the one who can resolve all issues. We thank you, Father God. Even though we don't fully know your capabilities, Father, we know that you are capable of dealing with anything that is in our lives, and we thank you for that. We thank you for resolution. We thank you, Father God, that you're moving even before we see you moving. We thank you for that in the name of Jesus. We thank you, God, that you allow us to meet you at the altar. You don't meet us, we meet you at the altar because you are already here. And we thank you for that. We thank you for being our omnipotent God. We thank you for, Father God, because you love us, Father God. Even when we don't deserve to be loved, even when we don't love ourselves, even when we don't love others, you love us. And for that, we say thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, Father God, that you love us for, even when we have thoughts that don't line up with your thoughts. In the name of Jesus, Father God, we thank you that you still love us. And we thank you that there's nothing that we can do that will make you love us more. We thank you that you're a consistent God. We thank you that you're never changing in the name of Jesus. Lord, we are wishy-washy people, Father God, but you are a consistent God, and we thank you for that in the name of Jesus. Lord Jesus, we need you. We need you right now. Lord, some of us come here to the altar worried. Some come in fear. Some come with no hope. But Lord Jesus, we thank you that your word says that you can make streams even in a desert place. So we thank you for that in the name of Jesus. Now, Lord, you know what's going on in this world. We don't even have to tell you. But Lord, thank you for allowing us to just tell you in the name of Jesus. Tell you our concerns, Father God. Lord Jesus, there was an assassination attempt yesterday. But Lord, you moved. You moved, Lord. Not because he had poor aim, but because you moved in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you, Father God. We thank you because you're not finished with Donald Trump. Lord Jesus, we thank you, Father God, that even when we can't love him, you love him, Father God. Lord, teach us to be more like you in the name of Jesus. Teach us to think like you and love like you in the name of Jesus, Father God. And Lord Jesus, we admit that it's hard. It's hard when we see someone's character, Father God, that doesn't line up with yours. But Lord, teach us to see with eyes like you in the name of Jesus. We want to be more like you in the name of Jesus.
When we come together as a community, we are giving God praise. When you are worshiping in your own home, on your own, because I know you don't just wait till Sunday to worship. I know you worship every day of your life. Worship is a way of saying thank you. And one of the ways through our worship that we say thank you is through the giving of our tithe and our offering. Giving is a part of worship. Giving is acknowledging that if it had not been for God's grace and mercy, we wouldn't have what we have. Giving is a way of saying thank you and recognizing that we are standing here only because God made a way. So let us prepare for the giving of our tithe and our offering. We give because God has been good. We also give because God has given us ministry to do. God has given us facilities to maintain. We have to continue to be there for our youth and help them in their various endeavors. We have to continue to be able to feed those who are living in food deserts or suffering from food insecurity. We have to give because there are many things that this city needs and we have to continue to fight. We have to give so that we continue to have AC in the summer and heat in the winter. I know y'all get real spiritual, I like to get real practical. Amen. And it is through us giving as a community where we do what God has called us to do. So let us recite our stewardship litany. It's time to give, Mount Lebanon. Has God been good to you? It is time to give our tithe. Who should tithe?
That every one of you lay by in his store, as God has prospered.
Should we tithe on gross or net income?
You should truly tithe all the increase of your seed that the field brings forth from year to year.
How much should we tithe?
Abraham gave a tenth of all you have.
What is God's promise to those who tithe?
I will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you will not have room enough to receive it.
How should I give today? What should I expect?
Then we shall give it to you, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall it be poured into your life. But with the same measure you give, it shall be returned to you again.
Amen. Let us all stand with our offering in hand as we prepare to go to God in prayer. You can give via Cash App, PayPal, or Zelle. You can also give, but no matter how you're giving on today, whether it be in the basket or electronically, we ask that we all march together in faith on this day. Amen. To those who are worshiping with us virtually, you can give electronically as we all give as a community. Let's lift our offering to the Lord as we go to God in prayer. Lord, we thank you for being the giver of every good gift. We thank you for being Jehovah Jireh, God who provides. We thank you because you always somehow, some way, allow the ends to meet, allow us to get through. And for that, we say thank you. We give back to you a fraction of all that you've given unto us. Bless both the gift and the giver as you continue to use us for your good in this day and age. You've called us for a particular purpose. Continue to reveal that to us and give us what we need to live up to your standard. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please follow the directions of the ushers as we bring our offering to the Lord.
Back to you, Lord.
young people are closing out the youth crusade on today, so they're going to come on this youth takeover and sing us good songs. Hope they look good. Encourage them on today. Come on, you can do better than that. Encourage them.
Amen. 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 So tell everyone that I know. So tell everyone that I know about you, God. God, we want to thank you for this moment. Thank you, God, for bringing us here. Amen.
Amen. God, we thank you, you know, for bringing us here into this moment in worship. I pray, God, that you will continue to speak, continue to move, continue to be God. I pray, God, that you will bless each and every one of these young people. That the words that they sing, oh God, may take hold on their lives. May take hold on their hearts. May arrest them, oh God. And they may come to know you in the most deepest, most intimate ways. Thank God that there is no distraction too high. That there is no peer pressure too pressure. There is no trap that has been set by the enemy that will never get them. Because it's covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. So God, we thank you for that. We thank you that your hedge of protection is over us. And we'll put the blood over their lives, over their steps, over every interaction that they may have with anyone in their life, over every camp that they attend, over every classroom that they're in. We plead the blood even now. In the name of Jesus. May you cover them, oh God, from the crown of their head even up to the sole of their feet. May you guide them and may you protect them. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Come on, give God some praise. And if you turn around and look at me into the book of John, chapter 4, it has been the theme and the book that we are working through.
Anyone who drinks this water will
soon become thirsty again. But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. It becometh a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life. Verse 15. Please, sir, the woman said, give me this water, that I will never thirst again, and I won't have to come here to get water. And Jesus said to her, go and get your husband. I don't have a husband, she responded. Jesus said, you're right. She don't have a husband, for you had five husbands, and you aren't even married to the man you are living with now. You certainly spoke the truth. She said, sir, the woman said, you must be a prophet. Let's skip some verses, go down to verse number 28. The woman left the water jar beside the well and ran back to the village, telling everyone, come and see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could he possibly be the Messiah? Amen. I'll speak to you this morning from a similar theme. Give me a drink. Give me a drink. Recently, I was, if you could just adjust the mic a little bit, would be appreciated. Recently, I was in Petra, which is in Jordan. It is one of those old ancient cities. It's one of the seven modern wonders of the world. And I was walking to a part of Petra, and in order for me to get there, I had to walk through the desert. Nothing was around me but sand and rocks and cliffs and nothing else. There was no spring of no water, there was no pool, there was nothing. And good thing, before I started this journey, I got a bottle of water to carry with me to take me through. And there I was at the point of the day where the sun was the most hottest. I was walking in the desert to find this place. And I look at the text and I wonder, why then would anyone want to walk in desert places, especially in the time of the day when it's the most hot outside? Anyone in their right mind, in their sensible senses, would want to avoid walking around at this point in time. And here in the text, we see the woman. We see the woman, Babbis call her a Samaritan woman. She is found in the place of Samaria. The text tells us, we know in scripture, that the Jews and the Samaritans have no dealings. They are opposites in some sense. The Jews consider the Samaritans to be unclean. Yeah. They're ceremonially unclean. They are not even worthy to be spoken to. The Jews will avoid at all costs to go into Samaria because they don't want to be unclean. They don't want to be around things and people that they deem to be unclean. They're so super spiritual and so righteous in their endeavors that in order for them to stay clean for themselves, they don't want to be around unclean folks. Jesus has a way of breaking down spiritual barriers and religious criteria in order to get the people that Jesus needs to get. Jesus didn't come for the righteous in the church who is stoic. He came for those in the club who people deem to be marginalized among the outcast of society. So Jesus decided that he must needs go through Samaria. Yeah. But there's something in Samaria that I need to get to. There's someone perhaps I need to see. So here he is, he goes through Samaria and he stops at this well, Jacob's well. And the Bible tells us that the woman comes to the well at noon, at midday. The sun is up in the sky, beating. And here she is walking with her bucket to get some water. Understand the social context of the text tells us that women usually go in groups to get water. One, and they usually go in the early morning before the sun comes out in order to get the water. This particular woman unity because of her past history, her present reality. And so therefore, there's some people that don't want to associate with her because of her past history and present reality. Talk to you because of your past history or your present reality. Because they don't see you in their class, see you in their league, see you in their category. They don't want to ostracize and outcast you because you're not a part of the clique and a part of the group and a part of the club. But that's alright. The woman still comes to get some water. And I have to imagine how she comes. She probably feels ashamed. Probably feels and knows that she is ostracized, knows that people probably don't like her the way that she wants to be liked. She is on the outskirts of society. People have been talking about her all her life. Things have got away and messed up in her life. And here she comes, needs to get water, needs to get something that will cause her to live her life in a peaceful way. So she must come to the well at some point in time in the day. And she decides to come when no one talks negatively about her or who looks at her in mocking ways or looks at her in disgust. So she comes at the time of the day when no one else wants to go. She comes when the sun is the most hot outside. She comes holding on her head with a bucket in her hand. Let me go do my business. Let me get some water. As she walks up to the water, as she walks up to the well, she sees a Jewish man sitting on the well. She probably wondering herself, why is this man sitting here? I thought, after all, no one's going to be around. Why is he here? I can't deal with this no more. Why is he here? She walks up, with her head down, she's trying to make eye contact with him and focus on her business. She gets to the well, trying to get her stuff done. And here this Jewish man looks at her and says to her, give me to drink. Understand that Jews don't deal with Samaritans. So this question, this statement, why is a Jewish man asking a Samaritan woman, one who the Jewish customs regard as unclean, to touch anything she touches, to drink of anything that she drinks from? Jesus is showing us that I am willing to go in any place that I need to go to and commune and have community with those who we think might be unclean. There is an image with this text. There's an image at the well. If you look back at the Old Testament scripture, there's a lot of withdrawals, a lot of love that starts at the well. A lot of the Old Testament guys met their wives at wells. There's something that God is an image of God marrying to those whose others have forsaken. He looks at her and he says to her, give me to drink. Right at this well, give me to drink. There's something about the text. There's something about this imagery of an unclean woman meeting a clean Savior that will come together to cause the unity and community in this text right here. Give me to drink. The woman looks at him and says, sir, what are you doing? Stop. You're doing too much. You're not supposed to be talking to me. I'm unclean. I'm a Samaritan. Like, what are you doing? Like, what, please? But Jesus looks at her again and says, no. If you only understood what I just asked you a while ago, you wouldn't even be going all of that back and forth. Give me to drink. I have something to offer you. Then the woman looks at him and says, hold up. You don't even have a robe. You don't have a bucket. You must be mad. Like, what's up? Like, what's really happening here? Like, you want to talk to me, not supposed to be talking to me. You don't come in prepared or equipped with a robe and a bucket to get the water. So what are you talking about? Why are you even sitting here? I'm sitting here because I was waiting for you.
Lost in who you
are. My identity is not found in you. This will develop me. The divorce will not destroy me. The divorce will develop me. The relationship failure will not destroy me. It will develop me. It will not define me. It will develop me. I will become stronger after this. This is the thing that we go through in relationships and we find ourselves looking for wealth. Looking for something to quench our thirst. The woman says to Jesus, if you know who you're talking to, I will give you to drink. And she says to him, sir, give me this water so I don't come back here and thirst anymore. And some Bible scholars believe that either one, she would be sarcastic. Yeah, right. Give me to drink. So I don't come back here. Yeah, right. Are you better than Jacob who built this well? Yeah, right. Give me to drink, yes. Or perhaps she was misunderstanding what he was talking about. But I dare to audition to say this morning that perhaps she knew exactly what he was offering. Perhaps there was something about this man sitting on the well that was different than she's ever seen before. Understand that this woman knows men. I think she knew how to pick up a man when she sees one. She knows a little thing about that. She knows a little thing about a man. She had five husbands, remember, she managed to know. So she understands, she can write a book on how to identify a good man. So perhaps there's something about this man sitting on this world, in this moment, on this day, in this heat, there was something different about him. She recognized that. Give me to drink. Give me to drink wasn't something that was sarcastic. Probably it wasn't something that was misunderstood. She understood that this man offered something that no other man that she had ever met in her life can offer her. Give me to drink. Let me drink from this well. Then let me drink from this water that will never allow me to thirst anymore. Give me to drink. Are you so different? I don't understand everything about this Jesus person right now. But there's something about him. There's something about his voice. There's something about his demeanor. There's something about being his presence that gets me to want to get more of him. Give me to drink. I've been searching for a water that I don't want to thirst anymore. I've been searching for something that will quench my thirst for attention of people that don't even love me, that they leave me. I've been searching for something to fill the void in my life. There's a thirst in me that other things have filled. But give me action that I'm addicted to anymore. Give me to drink so that I can have a full. Go back to the things that even made for me. Give me to drink so that I don't have to go back to find comfort in people's company that don't like me, that use me and abuse me. Give me to drink so that I don't have to find myself and find my meaning and find the importance of my life in people's voices and people's houses that don't make for me. Give me to drink so that I don't have to be sexually attracted to people that don't mean me no good. Give me to drink so that I don't have to go back to pornography. Give me the drink so that I don't have to go back to alcoholism. Give me the drink so that I don't have to go back to the thing that destroys my personhood, that destroys my person. Give me the drink. I'm thirsty for something different. I feel Jesus was offering something in this moment that no man, that no person, that no other thing in her life was offering. And the moment she gets in his presence, she's like, give me to drink. Sir, please, I don't want to suffer anymore. Sir, please, I'm tired of laying down for the wrong people. Sir, please, I'm tired of giving myself to people that need me no well. Sir, please, I'm living with a man that isn't even my husband. Sir, please, I'm messed up and jacked up. Give me to drink something that will heal me from the addiction. Give me to drink something that will save me from the things that I'm going through. Give me to drink. I need something more. I need something better. I need something that will change my life. Something that will quench my thirst. Something that will keep me going. Keep me on. Give me to drink. The Bible says that go and get your husband. And perhaps she looked, had her head down as a woman. Here we go again. The people that would know things about you and use it to harm you. And then the others who know things about you and use it to help you. She's used to people knowing things about her and using it to hurt her. But here Jesus comes first of everything that everyone has already knew. And she said to her, go and get your husband. And she had her head down. I'm like, sir, I don't have a husband. She's like, no, girl, I know you have, you're right. You have five husbands. And the man that you're living right now ain't even yours. He's borrowed property. Jesus, when you come into contact with him, he will speak the truth about your reality. Not to offend you, not to hurt you, not to define you, not to destroy you, but to develop you. When you come into contact with Jesus and the word of truth, it becomes a mirror that reflects your reality, but a futuristic mirror that also tells you where you're going. Go and get your husband. Said, no, I don't have a husband. Jesus confronts her about it, and she said, you must be a prophet. Because there's something that no one else knows some things about me but me. And all of us in this room have secrets. We have things about ourselves that we don't want to share with one else. But Jesus knows. The things that we'd rather not talk about, but Jesus knows. There's things that we'd rather not even mention, but Jesus knows. And in order for us to fill our well of our heart and quench our thirst, we must come to the truth, not the truth, that Jesus knows everything about you and still loves you. There's nothing you can hide from God. There's nothing about yourself that you can hide from him. And when you wake up in the night with tears running down your eyes, and tears falling from one side of your eye into the pillow, Jesus knows. When you feel insecure, and when you feel as if you have low self-esteem and lack of confidence because of the experiences that you're facing in life that has deteriorated and sapped at you, Jesus knows. When you have been through and been in situations where you rather not even tell people about where you have been, Jesus knows. And he will meet you where you are, and he will love upon you anyway. Go, don't try to hide your frailties and your inabilities and your imperfections from a God who knows it all and loves you nonetheless. The reason why Jesus confronts her about it, because Jesus wants her to know that I know and I still love you. What I know about you does not cause me to love you any less. I know you are messed up, but I still love you. This is the gospel. That Jesus will meet us in a place of our need and our vulnerability, and will call out to us in this moment of truth and this moment of confrontation that I love you. I know your past, honey. I know the things you have done and the things you have been through and the hell you have overcome. And I love you. I know your present reality. I know you don't have it together. I know that your night clothes this morning, you look good, they smell fresh and all of that, and you look wonderful right now. But I know that only all of that, you are still messed up on the floor of. But I still love you. There is nothing about your reality that I
know and choose not to love you. I know it and choose to love you anyway. When you have come in contact with God, God will tell you about yourself and still love every part of your being. I know that you're addicted to some things right now, but I still love you. I know that you're hiding a part of yourself, but I still love you. I know you're wrestling with who you are, wrestling with your identity, wrestling with where you want to be in life, but I still love you. Your present reality does not affect my love for you. I love you so much.
Because physical water allows a thirst
for the word that God has taken in her spirit. And she went away and she said, come see a man who tells me everything about myself. That's the battle. That's evangelism. That's simple as it. It is not to get up and preach and talk about 10 covers of scriptures and to say all of those wonderful, clear things that people they say. It is simply to tell people about someone who has touched and has changed your life. Come see a man who told me about myself. Come see a man who healed me when I was sick. Come see a man who delivered me when I needed to be delivered. Come see a man who stood beside me with all health, with broken rules. Come.
I don't know how to stand and preach like Pastor Lee. I don't know all of that.
this presence that's better than me. Come see her. Because when you come, when you taste, you see that is good. Come see her, who knows everything about you and loves you no better. Father, we thank you because you're God. And I pray, God, for a refreshing little child, a refreshing in your spirit, that we will be made new by your word, that we will be made new by you. God, I pray for a deeper thirst for you, God. That God, I've been trying to get a quench somewhere else from someone else. But God, we come to see you. We come to know you as the Lord and Savior, one who quenches a thirst. We love you this morning. We praise you this morning. And we thank you this morning. In Jesus' name. Amen.
I worship and adore.
praise if you mean it. You don't have to look for wells in other places. Jesus Christ is our living water. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise for that word on today. Our ushers are in place. We want to be a blessing to Minister Andre. Our ushers are now coming so that we can receive an offering. Our ministers are on staff. Let me tell you, we don't pay them enough for what they do. Amen. So when they bring forth the word, we want to be a special blessing to them. Let's pour back into their life. Our ushers are coming. We don't have them. We're going to have a special meeting with the ushers, amen. Yeah. I remember when I was young, ushers stopped us from walking and everything. Amen. Ushers with plates in hand. For those given virtually, you can give me a cash app, PayPal, Zelle. Come on, let us be a blessing to you this morning. PayPal, you can also give via Cash App, PayPal, and Zelle. Get home and enjoy the rest of your day. Amen. And it's my prayer you were able to hear what the word was saying to you on today. Stop looking for water or wells in other places. Jesus Christ is our living water, who knows everything about us and won't use it to hurt us, destroy us, or define us, but will use it to develop us. And know that as we leave the doors of this place, nothing will happen to you this week that you and God cannot handle together. So my prayer is that the Lord will bless you and keep you. The Lord will make his face shine upon you and be gracious toward you, and that the Lord will lift up his countenance upon you and grant each and every one of you peace. And all the people of God said, amen. Give your neighbor a hug. Let them know you love them. And let's leave in the joy of the Lord. God's got a blessing with your name on it.
God's got a blessing.
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 With your name on it.
With your name on it.
God's got a blessing.
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 With your name on it.
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 With your name.
With my name on it, God's got a blessing.
God's got a blessing.
Oh, 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 God's got a blessing.
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 With my name.
With your name on it.
God's got a blessing.
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 God's got a blessing. With your name on it.
With my name.
With your name on it.
With my name on it.
With your name on it.
With my name on it.
With your name on it.
With my name on it.
With your name.
God's got a blessing.
God's got a blessing.
Oh, God's got a blessing.
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 With your name on it.
With your name on it.
God's got a blessing.
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 With your name.